This has got, I've got like 180 slides in here. You don't want all these.
First one is the top three, top one.
Maybe you do. Okay. We're gonna start from the very beginning. We're just gonna review everything up to this point, okay? So, we got all day to get this done. We're still not gonna have enough time. Do you want this stuff?
No.
Everybody got it? Because I'm gonna be using this board space probably. First of all, I think you have to understand the language of electrophysiology, okay? I think one of the problems with EKG interpretation is that we teach pattern recognition, right? So you recognize this pattern. And if you know what that pattern is, you know the rhythm, right? But if you don't know what that pattern is, then there's no way to determine what might, or at least make an educated decision about what might be going on, right? So you don't, it's like high school Spanish class, right? I can make my way through a resort town in Mexico with a couple of phrases, right? But I am by no means fluent. So if you drop me off in Oaxaca, I'm probably screwed, right? But if you drop me off in Cancun, I could probably survive on beer and tacos and find a nice little hostel to stay in, right? Okay? Because I'm not fluent, right? I'm not fluent. If I was fluent, I could have a conversation, a difficult conversation, someone with a different dialect, and at least work my way through it, right? And be able to say, all right, I understand. This is something I have not heard before, right? Or this is a picture that I don't quite recognize, but I can at least have a conversation and get the gist of the picture of what's going on and have some meaningful discussion, right? If all I know is el baño, cerveza, taquito, and chihuahua, right? I'm not going to make it very far, right?
Could eat dog tacos and drink a beer.
Right, which, you know, I'd try anything once. So, but I think to really make this meaningful, you have to know the language of an electrocardiogram, okay? You have to know the language, all right? And the alphabet is a lot smaller than our 26 letters of the alphabet, right? It's a lot smaller than that. But there are some key little elements that you're going to have to know to put things together, okay? And it's all based on action potential. What is that electrical conduction? What does it mean? How does it happen? What is it expected to do? And how is it differing from the norm, right? So we have to have a very good understanding of what normal is so that we can say, all right, well, here's what I know is supposed to be happening. Here's what normal looks like. Here's what normal represents. And then you can start to speak the language of electrocardiograms, right? So we're going to go over basic EKG interpretation. We're going to spend probably the first hour just talking about the basic physiology of ECGs, okay? Then we're going to get into interpretation. And the way I do it is every 12 lead is rate, rhythm, axis, intervals, and ischemia, okay? Or ST, T wave abnormalities, okay? So it doesn't matter if I'm sinus rhythm, if I interpret a 12 lead, I say rates 80, normal sinus rhythm, normal axis, normal intervals, no ischemia, no ST to T wave abnormalities suggesting ischemia, no right heart strain patterns. That's normal, not normal, right? I don't just say that's a normal 12 lead. My normal is rate, rhythm, axis, intervals, ischemia, okay? That way I don't miss some little subtle ischemic change because I'm so fixated on the rhythm interpretation, right? Or vice versa. I don't miss the rhythm abnormality because I'm so fixated on the ST changes. You force yourself to go through it each step. So we'll talk about basic ECG interpretation. We're going to talk about our fast rhythms. Okay? We're going to talk about our slow rhythms and our blocks. We're going to talk about bundle branch blocks, intraventricular conduction abnormalities, right? Intraventricular conduction abnormalities, this just refers to abnormal conduction through the common bundle and the bundle branch blocks, okay? Sometimes this will call this is called aberrancy. You hear the word aberrancy, that's what it means. Faulty conduction through your ventricles, through the rapid pathways of the ventricles. Aberrancy, I don't know how to spell. A-B-E-R-E-N-C-Y, I don't know. There's two B's. Two R's in there somewhere, something like that. I can't spell, but I'm sorry. We're going to talk about ischemia, right? And you got to be good at this. You got to be able to pick this stuff up, okay? Sometimes it's real subtle, sometimes it's obvious, like the one you just showed me there. There's an obvious ischemia, right? There's no way you're going to miss that. You can't miss that. It's like driving into a semi, right? There's no way to miss that one. And we're going to talk about things that trip you up, okay? We in Spokane County, we have a, or at least for our cardiac level 1 activations for Spokane and Providence systems is a false positive rate of about 20%, okay? I would say half of those are EKGs that are just such shitty quality you can't interpret them, and the other half are left bundle branch block and left ventricular hypertrophy. Okay, so foolers. So we'll talk about foolers. Okay, that makes sense. So a lot on the plate, and it's going to all build on top of each other. Okay, so it's important that as we go through this. If you have questions or there's a concept that doesn't hit home, stop me, okay? And I will do my best to make sense of it, okay? If it's just not happening, if it's just you're just not making a connection but everybody else seems to be getting it, there's no shame in that, okay? I don't want to leave you behind, but that's probably a good time for us to take a break. Give me 5 minutes with just you, and everybody can go for coffee and bathroom and all that kind of stuff, and we'll try and knock it out, okay? And we're just gonna have to spread out our breaks throughout the course of the day, okay? What time do you guys wanna have lunch? 12:30, 12, maybe after this first section, okay, all right. All right, so here's our cardiac action potential. Okay, this is the fundamental element of what the EKG is, okay? This is the fundamental element. What the surface EKG is identifying is this signal. Now, this signal is the individual cell makes this signal. If I put a little electrodes on the inside of a cell and the outside of a cell, and I look at the electrical charge that takes place during the depolarization phase of that cell, this is what it looks like for a cardiac myocyte in red, okay? When I look at a cardiac cycle, PQRST, right? P wave, QRS complex, T wave, what I'm looking at is this series of events over the entirety of the heart in one cardiac cycle. So what I get is not one cell, I get a billion of these all firing in sequence, and it gives me that characteristic PQRST phenomenon, okay? But this represents the individual cell, right? You can see that a nerve cell is the most efficient cellular communicator. And that's how cells communicate. They depolarize, okay? You make one cell react to the adjacent cell is by a depolarization event, right? Okay? So Nerve cells are highly efficient communicators, okay? Cardiac myocytes are efficient communicators, but they pair that communication with a task, right? There's a mechanical task associated with it. Nerves don't have a mechanical task, right? All they do is communicate. That's it. They just communicate, okay? That's their function. Signal, point A to point B, right? Do this, do that, right? They don't do anything. Sit there and they just communicate. A myocyte communicates, but it also pairs with a mechanical task, so I need to have some delay in time for that to happen, okay? That mechanical task. So what I get is this refractory period where I can't send a new signal, right? I force a pause by the shape of this. I'm forcing a pause because I delay repolarization, okay? I delay repolarization back to the resting membrane's potential or that resting state where I'm, where my trigger is set, right? The trap is set. I'm waiting to spring that trigger, okay? It takes me a while to set that back up. Whereas a nerve cell, I can just fire off signals one right after the other, no problem, right? But I have a refractory period, a delay that inhibits a second signal until I'm ready, okay? So let's look at that single cell. I look at that single myocyte, okay? Here's the inside of my cell. Here's the outside of my cell, okay? I have a cellular membrane that surrounds each cell, right? And nestled in that membrane is a series of channels. We talked about this earlier, right? Channels, pumps, etc. And what that does is it sets up a gradient. Okay, I use ATP to generate a gradient where I pump sodium out and potassium in. They're both positive charges, but if I pump 3 out and 2 in, that's a net difference of 1, right? So if I do that a zillion times, then I generate that charge. So I've created a battery, essentially, right? I've created a battery. Each cell is a battery. It wants to inherently come back to an equivalent state. Right? I want to have equal charges on either side. So when I have more negative charges on the inside, that's my resting membrane potential. That's where I am ready to signal. Okay? I'm ready to signal. Is when I'm in a negative state on the inside of the cell, positive state on the outside of the cell, and I'm loaded, ready to drive some sort of action. And I use the polarity there. I use that gradient that's established to drive the process, right? I can't make things happen if I don't have any drive, right? If I have no motivation, I can't get up and do anything, right? My motivation is to make the outside and the inside equal in terms of charges. It's a battery, right? Exactly what a battery is, okay? Which my car battery died this morning. Totally unreliable. So if I look at this little sodium-potassium pump, yeah, go ahead, John.
Quick question. So back real quick, back to the refractory period.
Yeah.
You need to have that because your mechanical part needs to work, right? First.
Right. So what it does is it allows me to complete my motor function of the myocyte. Okay. Because otherwise, I would just signal right on top of each other. Boom, 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 right? And then I get all these signals, but I don't have any time to pair it with a motor event, right? So if I'm a neuron, it doesn't matter because I don't pair anything with a motor event. I don't squeeze anything. I don't do anything. I just signal. That's it. But if I'm a motor cell, a muscle cell, part of my job is to contract. So I have to have some time to complete that task before I reset. And this is the ingenious way... Whether evolved or created, muscles are, right? We won't have that debate here, but I don't care how it got this way, it's this way, and it works great, right? Because now I've got a delay here that allows me to pair it with something, okay? Does that make sense?
Yep.
Okay. So I look at this potassium pump, and this is what drives it, ATP, adenosine triphosphate, right? Goes to adenosine diphosphate. What I do is I cleave that phosphate off of there, and that makes energy, okay? ATP, that's what we drink our Gatorade for, and our eat our bread and have our cereal and whatever else, right? That's what I'm making, right? When I suck in oxygen and I utilize sugar, I create ATP. If I don't create ATP, then I'm in an anaerobic state, right? One of the ways I can't create any of this stuff is if I get, if I end up with, poisoning, cyanide poisoning. Uncouples your ability to use oxygen, so I can't make ATP, right? I'm anaerobic metabolism at that point. Aerobic metabolism gives me a very large production of ATP. Well, I'm using oxygen and sugar to make this little guy here that makes this pump that creates a gradient that charges my battery so that I can drive a process later on. Make sense? So if we break this down, this is the inside of my cell, right? Inside of my cell, this gray is the membrane. These are my various channels that populate that membrane, okay? In the resting state, I've created a gradient where I pumped sodium out and I pumped potassium in. Now you'll notice I leak a little bit of potassium in the resting state. I will get a little bit of leak of potassium. Not a lot, I'll get a little bit. But I'm closed to sodium and calcium, right? And I maintain a resting membrane potential of negative 90 millivolts, which is right here, negative 90. So when I'm ready to go, I sit at phase 4, right? Phase 4 is my resting membrane potential. I am polarized, right? Meaning I have negative charges inside, positive charges outside in comparison to each other. I'm polarized, I'm ready for action, okay? When I depolarize, I get this very rapid increase in intracellular charges so that I go from a negative 90 even to the point where I'm now in the positive, I'm like positive 110 or positive 10, positive 20. Right? I get such a flood of positive charges, particularly sodium initially, but also a little calcium. I get such a flood of positive charges in, I overshoot, right? I end up with, now I'm positive inside the cell, right? That's called depolarization, right? I go from a negative state, approach zero, and even overshoot a little bit, okay? Make sense? But this is important to know. It's an all or none phenomenon. These channels open based on what your charge is inside the cell. So they'll stay closed at negative 90. But if I hit negative 85, right, they all open. And they all open at once. Okay? It's not like one says, oh, I'll open. The next guy says, I'll open too, I suppose. And the next one says, maybe I'll open up a little bit later, right? They open all at the same time. It's called an all or none phenomenon, an all or none voltage gated channel. By opening all of them at once, I get this very rapid flood in, right? I get this huge charge difference where they go from a huge gradient to zero, and now just a little bit positive. And then I reset things back up, right? I shuttle calcium, so my sodium channels are open. I shuttle calcium, I start shuttling potassium, and I set myself back up into a polarized state. So you'll notice that these ones are critically important to arrhythmias, we talked about the other communicating cell that's important is a neuron. So we know that low sodium, low calcium, they can all cause seizures also because they're interfering with the action potential. But they can also cause cardiac arrhythmias, okay? Tricyclic overdoses, blocked sodium channels. So I take this and I go from being fast, I go to being slow. So I get a slow depolarization. And it makes my QRS wide because it's slow to depolarize the whole process. I depolarize slowly, as opposed to rapidly, so I get a wide QRS as opposed to a rapid quick QRS, right? But tricyclics also cause seizures, right? Because I'm interfering with sodium channels, which are critically important for cellular communication, okay? We'll get into that a little bit. But remember, sodium, potassium, calcium, all critically important for cellular signaling. These are the ones that we care. These are the electrolytes that we care about, okay? And magnesium. Don't ask me how or why, but magnesium's in there too, okay? Right? Very important electrolytes.
So we started talking about this and then got on a tangent during the big lab. That leaking of K, when you get to the negative 85 instead of 90, is that where you're getting your secondary pacemakers from?
We'll get into automaticity here in just a second.
Okay, all right.
But eventually, yes. But this is a much more stable membrane. A ventricular myocyte is a far more stable membrane than a Purkinje fiber, which is a little less stable than a junctional, which is a little less stable than, or which is a little more stable than my SA node. My most unstable membrane is my pacemaker, because it moves. You'll see this slope change in a couple of slides here. This doesn't remain flat. It never stays at a resting membrane potential of negative 90. It always spontaneously moves towards depolarization until it hits that all or none phenomenon, and then I get a reaction. Okay? We'll talk about that in just a second. So, cardiac action potentials, they're going to differ significantly in different portions of the heart. What we see here is a myocyte. This is the meat of the heart. This is the pumping portion of the heart. This is not my specialized conductive tissue. This is the bulk, the vast majority of my heart is a ventricular myocyte. They're in the atrium and in the ventricle, right? Right? It's the vast majority. It's the vast majority of the cellular makeup, right?
So with the action that seems like, okay, when we depolarize,
mm-hmm.
we go in negative or go in positive?
When you depolarize, you're taking what is a predominantly negative charge inside the cell,
okay,
and a positive charge outside the cell, and you are making them more equivalent. Okay? So outside the cell is a huge space, right? Outside of the cell is a huge space. So I don't really focus on the charge outside of the cell. It's easier for me to say I'm going to control the charge inside the cell. So we refer to it as a negative charge that moves towards zero, right, as opposed to the external space, which is a technically positive charge that moves towards zero. It's easier to say I'm focused on the cell, not on the extracellular space, okay? So it's a negative charge inside the cell that is becoming more like its external environment with each depolarization event. Make sense?
Okay, and then it slowly leaks out.
Are you talking about the deep? Are you talking about the resting?
Yeah.
So go back to this one. So I'm going to pump potassium in, and I'm going to pump sodium out. And I do that with each cycle, each phosphorus that I burn with a sodium potassium pump, I bring 2 potassium in, 3 sodium out. That's a net charge of negative 1, right? 3 and 2. So I'm 1 positive on the outside. That means I've got a difference here of a positive negative. If I do that 5 times, I'm positive 5 outside, and I'm 0 on the inside, right? But I'm not going 5 and 0. What I'm doing is I'm creating a gradient. And as I create a gradient, I can measure that gradient based on how large that polarity is as a millivolt, right? So I take my little voltmeter, and if I create enough of a gradient, I can measure it. So the inside, this is negative 70, but in this circumstance, I'm negative 90, okay?
So does it go to negative 90 and then start leaking out to like 85 where it trips?
So I go down to negative 90, and then I'm going to maintain there. You get very slow, very little potassium leaks back out. very little potassium leaks back out, okay, in your ventricular myocyte. But I get a lot more leaking, and we'll look at that, with the nodal tissue and some of the other conductive tissue, okay? That makes sense?
Okay.
We'll look at a couple of more diagrams here in just a second. The variability in action potentials and their thresholds allows for different electrical characteristics in the different portions of the heart. So by manipulating the what sort of channels and the membrane integrity that I have, by manipulating that, I can give you certain electrical characteristics, right? So if I change the membrane of an SA node, then I change the integrity of that membrane, it will have a different action potential, and it will have unique electrical properties, okay? That's how I get specialized electrical tissue, right? So when we're looking at those hearts the other day and we look at it, I can't say this is the tissue that is the, you can't see your bundle branch when you look at the heart. It's all meat, right? It's all muscle, okay? But the membrane, the makeup of the membrane of the cells in that area or that territory or that tract give it unique electrical properties that allow you to have specialized conductive tissue within the heart. From a bulk standpoint, from a mass standpoint, it makes up far less in terms of the amount of cells that are utilized, but they're specialized muscle cells, specialized to have unique electrical properties that are possible because I have a different membrane characteristics. So I will leak a little bit more. I'll have a action potential that's slightly different based on what I need it to do. Okay?
When the conduction is slowed through the AV nodule,
yeah.
Is that due to it polarizing less, or is it due to calcium or sodium that they depolarize faster? Is it the same faster?
So you have a slower depolarization event. You could do that by several ways. One is you could just have your threshold potential differently, so that I'm not going to trigger a depolarization event until I have a certain charge that's harder to approach, right? So I'm not going to depolarize at negative 80, which requires very little trigger. I'm going to depolarize at negative 30, which requires quite a bit of gradient change before I have an all or none phenomenon, okay? And each of those is going to be uniquely different, okay? And then you can slow that conduction, you can slow the transmission based on how fast you will achieve that.
Do sodium and calcium, do they conduct the nerve signals at the same speed? Do they transmit those signals through? Does that make sense or not?
Well, it's not, you can't say the sodium and calcium channels specifically. Right? I mean, each channel will have a different properties. Like, you'll have what's called a funny sodium channel in some of the nodal tissue, which conducts differently than your rapid sodium channels that open quickly, right? So instead of this guy that opens quickly, I'll have a different one called a funny sodium channel that has a different rate of opening and a different membrane potential threshold, okay? So it takes more to trigger it.
Those two ions, like, they conduct cardiac action potential through the
It's not how fast these conduct anything, right? These aren't conducting anything. All this guy is doing, this is a dumb sodium ion, right? All it's doing is, like, sees the door and it walks through the door, you know? It goes, all right, right? Like, hey, it's crowded on this side of the door, so I'm going to this side of the door. That's all they do, right? They can only move across a channel at a certain intrinsic rate. It's what populates that cell's membrane, how frequently I have doors open, right? How many little kind of weak spots in the membrane where I can just say, oh, I'm going to sneak through here and slide through, right, through a crack in the wall, right? Depending on how integrous that barrier is what makes up depolarization. It has nothing to do with how fast the sodium moves back and forth. That's not going to change. not like some sodium ions are faster than other sodium ions. They move all at the same rate. It's how many opportunities do I have to cross over uninvited, right? Versus, hey, we're ready for you. Everybody come across. And then it's just like you open up the barn door and everybody floods across at the same time. Does that make sense? Well, look at a couple of these. Don't get caught up in, we could do a semester on electron transport across membranes, the different types of channels, the different types of voltage-gated channels, action potentials, right? You could go into more depth than you ever want to, or I want to ever go into, okay? Right? Maybe you could write a master's thesis on it if you want to. I don't want to write a master's thesis. I just want to understand the basic principles of it so that when I look at a 12-lead, I can say, all right, that makes sense, okay? Right? So don't get caught up in too much of that detail, but I want to make sure you get it enough that we can kind of make a good foundation here. So these important physiologic differences in ion channels and mechanisms of polarization, right? So how well I can maintain a gradient is what gives me these specialized conduction pathways within the heart. They're all muscle cells, but I have populations of cells in a circuit, essentially, that are specialized tissue. They have unique membrane properties that allow them to be perform electrical tasks. Okay. So here's an SA note, right? Here's what we've been focusing on because it makes up the bulk of my action potential. I get very rapid depolarization followed by repolarization in a stable resting membrane state. But let's look at my SA node and look at, I have these unique, here's that funny sodium channel, right? IF is a funny sodium channel, okay? Funny sodium channel. I have a calcium T channel, I have a calcium L channel, right? So I have calcium L channels here, but calcium T channels are unique, okay? I have a potassium channel, right? So I have all these different channels, but look, they have a different makeup. I have different channels, and they have different thresholds, okay, that gives me this unique depolarization property, okay? So what I get right here is I get this leak. I don't have a great membrane stability here, right? I have a leak. There's a leak in my system. I have a battery that's got a short circuit, so to speak. Right? I'm losing my charge. It's like having, that's why you keep your car, you keep muddy and wet stuff off your battery terminal post because you can have a slow leak across the post, right? It's the same thing. I got a slow leak across the post of my battery terminal, right? So I slowly lose that charge. I lose that polarized state. I lose my charge, okay? And then I meet, what it does is it moves me towards this threshold potential where I have, now I trigger my all or none phenomenon, right? I trigger this phenomenon at a different rate than I would over here because I have different membrane potential. But this allows me to spontaneously move towards a depolarization event, right? So now instead of having to be nudged to do anything, right? That's what's unique about this SA node is it is self-motivated, right? It's self-motivated. It doesn't have to be said, hey, go do your chores. It wakes up and says, I'm doing my chores, right? It moves towards a depolarizing event and self-sustains depolarization. And so it becomes a pacemaker. Does that make sense? It has less integrity in that membrane. So I set up, I repolarize after my event, back down to a negative state on the inside of the cell, but I slowly allow electrons to leak across that membrane, right? Primarily through that funny sodium channel. So I allow it to leak across the membrane until I reach this threshold potential, and then everything opens up. So this threshold potential right here is the equivalent of this spot right here where I met that all or none phenomenon and I get an event. And this one, I move towards that phenomenon and I get an event. And I spontaneously move to that phenomenon and then I get an event. Okay?
So the reason why it's not firing at that threshold when it's coming down to 3 is because it's in a refractory period. And it's
right.
Depressed. And it can't be refired at that point?
Right, it's repolarized. I'm repolarizing. So now I'm, this is the phase where that sodium potassium pump is now taking my sodiums and my potassiums and shuttling them back across, right? This phase is the equalization of that. Now I'm going to work to get everything back together, okay?
Is that the absolute refractory period, or is that not even related to this? To me, it would make sense that as soon as it hits the threshold, it's going to fire again.
Oh, at this spot right here?
Yeah.
Okay, so it comes back down and hits this and then goes back up? Right,
is that the absolute refractory period or
relative
or why? Why is it not refiring once it hits the threshold?
Okay, so why doesn't it come down like this and pop back open again? Well, you got to consider the fact that I have channels open here that are not open here, right? So I'm still moving towards creating a gradient that is otherwise non-existent right here, right? I've got to have a setup gradient to do that. Right now I have channels that are still open that don't allow me to create that state. So I would say that this puts us into your absolute refractory period. I can no longer have an event. I can't have an event till I move back to a resting membrane potential, okay? So you don't have the capability of firing in here. Now, that being said, you can trigger some phenomenon during this phase. You ever heard of an R-on-T phenomenon, right? An R-on-T phenomenon is like the commotio cordis type thing. That's why you do synchronized cardioversion for rhythms when you can. You set somebody and you sync, and then you do synchronized cardioversion instead of blind defibrillation on things like narrow complex tachycardias, because I don't want to cause an event here, but what I'm doing in those circumstances is I'm adding some sort of impulse, right? It's not the spontaneous depolarization. I'm adding something onto this phase that triggers an event. It's not a spontaneous event. I'm introducing current to create something right here. And if I do that during that repolarization phase, I can induce things like VTAC and VFib. Okay?
Does the SANO have a higher threshold, and that's what makes it the one that acts first? Or
it's not the higher threshold that makes it act first. It's the spontaneous move towards depolarization.
So
does it leak faster then?
Yeah, it leaks. It leaks across. Instead of that membrane being, so if I want to create a really solid gradient here, right? Then I'm going to keep my positive charges on this side of the classroom, and I'm going to keep my negative charges on this side of the classroom. Negative charges are on the inside of the cell. This is the inside of the cell. This is the outside of the cell, and you guys in the middle are my cellular membrane. Okay. I've pushed all my positive charges this way, and now I have a net negative on the inside, right? It's your job to keep them from crossing over to this side, okay? So I've got you guys set up, right? 2, 1, 1, 1, 2, okay? I got pretty good coverage all through here. They're not coming across unless you guys step out of the way and let them cross, right? But let's say Cody gets up to go to the bathroom, right? Now I have an unprotected area in this barrier. So they're going to start to sneak through slowly, right? They're going to move across, right? And they're going to move to a state, and if they achieve a certain state, then everybody has to stand up and let them cross, right? I mean, it's kind of a difficult analogy that I'm trying to create here, right? But once they reach a certain point, you guys all have to just get up and let them pass. That's a threshold potential, okay? Make sense? But as long as you're all here protecting these little spaces between the desks, they're not going to get across, okay? But an SA node allows, there's some gaps, right? Brianna moves back a seat. Now I got a big gap in here, right? You get up to go get coffee. I got another gap in here, right? So I have unprotected barrier or an unprotected membrane, and so I'm going to slowly lose my charge to this side of the room. Okay? Does that make sense? That is automaticity.
I think with the refractoriness that we're talking about is, we talked about absolute refractory theory. No matter what, even if you introduce an outside source, the cell cannot regenerate. The relative, so after we pass back below that threshold, are we in a relative refractory period? If there's an outside charge that comes to play, can then the cell depolarize again?
Technically, based on an RMT phenomenon, you wouldn't be in an absolute beyond this spot here. What do they define? I have to look at the definition of what they call absolute and relative. So here's the problem with this diagram is we're really a step ahead. We're still at a single cell. Okay. We're still looking at a single cell. So it's hard to say, it's hard to take absolute and relative refractory, because what that's looking at is a surface EKG where I'm looking at every single cell at the same time. So let's go back to that, okay? But try not to throw it in right here, but it is related to this downhill side where I have a repolarization phenomenon versus this uphill side where I am in the process of depolarizing. Okay.
I guess my question was, can a single cell change its threshold, fire off, and then make the rest of them fire off?
A single cell's not changing anything. That's the way it is.
So it can't lose or gain threshold. It's not going to go up. The channels are going to stay the same its entire life.
Well, let me take that back. What it is born with, right? What it is designed as, that's not going to change how that works when it's not in a pathologic state, right? But remember that I can influence cells, inotropes, dronotropes, chronotropes. That's all an influence on how well and how fast they conduct, right? So I can manipulate the action potential by vagus nerve stimulation. Parasympathetic and sympathetic intervention can manipulate the action potential, right? Pathologic states like sodium channel blockers or tricyclic overdoses can manipulate that action potential, but that's a process that's exerting its effect on the channels itself. That's how you get that effect.
Okay.
You're exerting an impact on, but from a in its normal physiologic state, it's not becoming more like another cell or like this cell. It is what it is, okay? Now, we can manipulate that cell with medicine.
But we're not
going to
change the threshold.
I'm not going to change the threshold of that cell,
on any
or
cell.
It's not going to impact its neighbor and make it become a nodal tissue.
Okay.
If my neighbor is a myocyte, they're a myocyte. Right?
Even if they...
If I'm an SA nodal cell, I'm an SA nodal cell. We might be neighbors, but he's not going to be one of me, and I'm not going to be one of him.
He's not going to fire off before you and make you fire off.
Unless he's has a pathologic process.
Okay.
Okay? Does that make sense? Are we going into the weeds here? Is everybody still on board?
I got a quick question.
Yeah.
The reason, you would think that an action potential to SA nodes would be huge because it's the fastest, but also...
What do you mean huge? What do you mean huge?
Like it would be higher.
It's huge.
Yeah, it would be higher.
No.
It would go higher.
No, just leaks faster.
No. They're not going any higher. Look, this is just, I'm barely overshooting zero right here. Right? I'm barely overshooting zero. Right? My resting membrane potential is lower. Right? So my resting membrane potential is different, but I'm not shooting up any higher. I overshoot a little bit. All I'm doing is trying to approach zero.
No, so it's the same.
Yeah, I'm just approaching zero. Okay? I get a little bit over the top because an action potential is like opening the floodgates. And once you open the floodgates, it's hard to be like, whoa, okay, I'm exactly where I want to be. Shut the doors, right? You're gonna take on a little extra when you open that many doors, and that's what's happening. I overshoot a little bit, and I correct. I overshoot a little bit, and I work back down. Yeah.
Along those same lines of his question, so the reason why this is such a small bot, if I understand correctly, is because this is a small area of the heart, and so there's not a lot of energy being created. Whereas like the ventricles, it's a huge area, so bigger spike.
You're not seeing this bump on a surface EKG. You don't see this event.
That's not what you would.
No. This triggers the event. This is the very beginning of the P wave. It is not the P wave. What you see with the P wave is the atria doing this. This is too small of an area, right? Far too small. You're getting ahead into the surface EKG. We're not at the surface EKG yet, so back up. We're still on understanding the different characteristics of the heart. We have not looked at the surface EKG yet. We will get there, I promise, and I have a diagram that will make it make sense, okay? But right now, we are just differentiating the unique properties of the conduction system and differentiating it from the ventricular myocytes or the muscle cells that actually do the pumping, okay? Yeah.
Do these cells, these nodal cells in the pathways, are they actual muscle cells?
They're muscle cells.
They contract?
They're muscle cells. They're muscle cells.
In the contraction, though.
They are muscle cells. Yeah. They do very little to contribute to the overall contractility of the heart. They are really specialized to be unique conductors. Okay. To be electrical properties. They have intrinsic contractile property because they are myocytes. But they make up such a small, small segment of the mass, or such a small proportion of the mass of the heart, it's inconsequential.
Could you even see them twitch if you had the heart open and were dissecting?
No.
You couldn't even see them.
The only way that they know where this stuff is to take an electrode in the heart, and instead of looking at the surface EKG, they take an electrode, this is what the electrophysiologists do, right? They get in, they access the groin, either by a vein or an artery. If they access the vein, they have access to the right side of the heart, right, through the vena cava. If they access an artery, they have access to the left side of the heart through the aorta, right? So a lot of times they'll access a vein and an artery, run catheters up both sides, have catheters in the right portion of the heart, catheters in the left portion of the heart, and they will map out the heart, right? So they take a little catheter and they touch a tissue, and they look at what pattern shows up on the monitor. And if they touch that tissue and this is the pattern they get, they know they're looking at a myocyte in that territory, right? So they take the catheter and they go around and they look for little unique changes, and now I'm getting a bunch of this shape, I'm getting a bunch of this shape, and then all of a sudden I hit a spot and I'm like, ooh, I got a different action potential. That's nodal tissue. That's my SA node. So that's how they map it out. But again, that is a fine wire catheter that is not looking at the surface of the heart, where I am looking at a kind of a 10,000 foot perspective. I'm right up adjacent to that bundle of cells, and I'm going, what are you? You are an action potential that's a ventricle, right? And I come over here and I, or a myocyte. And I come over here and I go, you are an action potential that's a nodal cell. So you're my SA node. And that's how you map out a heart. So when I go in and I say, I want to burn your AV node, I don't just go in and be like, I think it's right here, right? I go in with a little catheter and I go, is that nodal tissue? No. Is this nodal tissue? No. This nodal tissue? No. This nodal tissue? Yes. And I burn it, okay? But I'm looking at small portions of tissue for these various signals. That's how I map out and diagram the heart, right? That's how I know that tissue's there. It's not by saying you look different, because they look the same from a physical proper, from a physical perspective. They look the same. Even under a microscope, I can't look at them and be like, well, you got different looking membranes, right? Because I can't see that well, right? It's the electrical properties that make them unique, which are the channels on that membrane, which is far too small to see with a naked eye, far too small to see with a microscope. let alone the naked eye. That makes sense?
Mm-hmm.
So pacemakers are specialized tissue that has a special property of depolarizing, moving towards this threshold potential, right, without any external influence. That is called automaticity. Okay? It's spontaneous depolarization or a spontaneous move towards depolarization, and they have reduced permeability of potassium, but they allow passive transfer of sodium and calcium. So I have passive transfer of sodium ions and calcium ions right here, funny sodium, calcium T channels, right? Where I allow that spontaneous move towards depolar. So I make all this effort with my sodium potassium to move all my potassium to this side of the room, all my sodiums to this side of the room, get that little ATP pump chugging, 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 move all my sodiums here, all my potassiums here, and then I say, okay, mingle, right? So all my sodiums and some calcium start to mingle back over, right? And as soon as they get over here, at one point, it's a party, right? And all the doors open, okay? So it's spontaneous move across that membrane because of a lack of integrity of that membrane. I move towards that potential, which causes everything to fire off. And once this guy fires off, once he triggers his neighbor. That guy triggers his neighbor, right? And then you get this depolarization event with a starting point, right? Because all events need a starting point, right? All this does is ensure that I have a starting point. Once it starts, the race is on, and I get a whole depolarization sequence that runs all the way through the heart. Okay? Yeah.
And everything that's inside, the partygoers inside the party, that CO2, they turn into lactic acid? The sodium, the calcium?
No.
The potassium?
Don't.
Okay.
We're not even going there right now. So it's not that it's a bad question. It's just that'll take us way out into
the
woods. And I think there's potential to confuse more than help at this point. But if you still have the question unanswered, we'll talk.
Okay.
Hey, Doc. So yeah. Pacemaker site, do you have a bunch of those cells that are going to kind of do all that
mm-hmm.
in the same rate, or do you have one cell?
You don't have just one cell.
First?
You don't have just one cell. You have a cluster of cells with that property.
They're going to time
right?
out the same.
Right, and they're going to be pretty equivalent. One probably is going to be the initiator, right? But you have a cluster of them that have those properties, right? So something has to start it. So I'm sure one cell begins. But truthfully, it's probably an event of several cells that triggers each event. Okay? But you think about ischemic tissue, right? And an irritable focus in the ventricle, right? It's what you get why people who have heart attacks have arrhythmias. They're fast, fast arrhythmias, right? I have diseased little part of the ventricle. One of them has to just pop off at some point. What was the analogy that you had the other day, like in... the guy who lets the arrow slip with the orcs. Lord of the Rings, where the guy's got his arrow, and there's all the big standoff, and he loses his arrow, right? And then the battle begins. So somebody has to start the event. It's not like they say, hey, I'm going to let my arrow go in like 10 seconds. All right, guys, everybody on the same page, so they'll never know who really started it. We're just going to all let it go in 10 seconds, right? 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, boom. Right? Someone triggers the event. So some little cell gets irritable and excites all the irritable cells around them, and that creates an event, okay? So here's what it looks like. Here's where I start things out, right? Here's my SA node, okay? I have my cells of the SA node that are time zero, trigger my event, right? What happens then, it's like take a crystal clear pond, right? Crystal clear pond. And I take a rock, and I throw that rock up in the air, right in the middle of the pond. And it goes plunk, right? And that wave goes, and it goes all the way across, right? That's what happens This is throwing the rock in the middle of the puddle and, or the pond. And what happens is I get that electrical signal is now conducted all the way through that atrium, right? It's a little pebble. It goes, and then all of a sudden you got a ripple that encompasses the entire pond. Okay? That's how it works. And it's one cell triggering the next, triggering the next, triggering the next. Okay? Now, ventricular myocytes are not very efficient at triggering each other, right? So just pure myocytes are slow conductors, right? But if I get that signal onto a specialized tissue like nodal tissue, fundal branches, Purkinje fibers, they are really good at conducting, and it goes from point A to point B much faster, okay? And that will be important to understand in a bit, okay? So let's go back and let's just look at a cluster of cells. Let's just look at some of them, right? So let's say this guy is triggered. This cell is depolarized. And how does it transmit that signal to these other cells? And it's going to be an amplified event, right? Because I trigger one guy, that guy triggers three guys, three guys trigger nine, nine triggers 32, 32 triggers however many, right? It's going to be an amplified event. So how does that happen? And how it happens is these things called gap junctions. So if I have a cell adjacent to the next cell, you can see here's the intercalated discs. Here's the distinction between these two cells. Okay? Here's a cell with a nucleus. Here's a cell with a nucleus. Here's a cell with a nucleus. Here's a cell. If I look at the little space where those two cells come together, for myocytes, I have these little gap junctions, okay? So if I take the membrane of this cell and I allow a surge of sodium in that changes the polarity of this cell, some of that is going to make its way through these gap junctions to the adjacent cell, okay? So changing the polarity of this cell influences the polarity of the next cell. Does that make sense? Okay. So when I go back here, the little nudge that takes me from resting membrane potential to that threshold gradient where I open all of my sodium channels at once is the slow leak from my adjacent neighboring myocyte that depolarizes me because they leaked over some of their depolarization channel or some of their depolarizing ions leaked over into the adjacent cell. And so this guy says, whoops, I'm going to fire too. And it leaks to its neighboring cell. So they all leak ions to the subsequent neighboring cell, which makes them hit their triggering voltage-dependent channel, and they open theirs. And then they get a flooding. Does that make sense?
Yeah, but aren't they doing it on purpose, though? But when you say leak, it's like... It's
what do you mean?
Accident. But aren't they doing it on... Isn't this on purpose?
A leak is not an accident. It's not an accident, right? You're thinking like, wet in the bed, leak, accident. This is no accident, right?
This is on purpose.
This is an intentional... This is an intentional communication between cell A and cell B. So that cell B will get the same signal and respond like cell A, right? This is absolutely intentional. It is a leak that is intentional. It is a communication portal. We'll call it that instead of a leak. It is a communication portal to ensure that the depolarizing event in cell A contributes to the subsequent depolarization of cell B.
That communication isn't via ion, right?
It is. This sodium, this is the inside of the cell, right? Inside of a cell, outside of a cell. Sodium floods in during that depolarization event, and some of that sodium now floods into this cell, right? Because this one got triggered. It got triggered to reach that threshold potential, so all sodium channels open up. So now it got nudged, it opens up sodium channels, they all flood in. It nudges the subsequent adjacent cell, it triggers its event, and now you've got like a wave in a stadium, right? each guide triggers the adjacent guy to stand up, triggers, and then before you know it, you've made it all the way around the stadium faster than you could run, right?
Perfect game of telephone.
Yeah, perfect game of telephone. Make sense? Does it?
Mm-hmm.
We're on the same page. Okay. So let's look at the various properties of the heart. Okay? We've talked about what makes these unique properties possible. Well, let's look at the unique properties of the heart. Okay? I have an SA node that started everything out. Starts the event because it has automaticity, right? Triggers an event. That event, like a ripple in a pond, right? I throw it up, it ripples out, right? That event happens at about half a meter a second when I talk about muscles. So the vast bulk of my atria and the vast bulk of my ventricle is going to conduct through muscles, atrial and ventricular muscle, at about a half a meter a second. Okay? So my P wave, I kind of get this slow depolarization. Here's my SA node fires right here. I have a depolarizing event, right? Happens right there. I get this kind of slow depolarization of my atrium at 5 meters per second. So this is atrial depolarization, right? And everything kind of converges. I can't conduct from my atria through to my ventricles except through the AV node, right? Because I have this kind of cartilaginous skeleton of the heart and I have AV dissociation. So imagine a boundary. I can't communicate electrically from top to bottom except through the AV node. So I have an inherent AV nodal delay, right? So now I have this really slow conduction through the AV node while things are paused and delayed. That allows for the mechanical movement of blood from the atrium to the ventricles. It creates a delay so that I get time to fill my ventricles after depolarization of the atria. This is not the squeeze, this is the electrical signal. This is the electrical signal, not the squeeze, right? This allows for depolarization plus the mechanical squeeze to fill my ventricle, right? And then when my AV node releases that signal, which it's been slowly holding on to and slowly transmitting, then I get this very, and look at this, this is half a meter a second. Or I mean 0.05 meters per second. So very slow conduction through the AV node, right? And then I get rapid conduction through the bundle of His, my left bundle, and my right bundle. And those happen at about 2 meters per second. So 4 times faster than a myocyte, right? 4 times faster than a ventricular myocyte is how I can conduct through my bundle branches, right? So I get my His bundle, my His, my bundle branches, right? Kind of the latter portion of that PR interval. And then once it gets out to the Purkinje fibers, which really distribute it everywhere, at 4 meters per second, so 8 times faster than the ventricular muscle, then I get slow depolarization of the ventricle, but it happens all at the same time, right? So instead of being a ripple in a pond like you get in the atrium, the signal goes everywhere and everybody excites at the same time, right? Or pretty damn close to the same time, okay? So my pond analogy doesn't work well when I'm on the rapid conduction pathway of the heart. It only works if I have atrial muscle depolarization or if I have a ventricular origin rhythm, it would be the same way because I start in the ventricle and I slowly depolarize out. But if I'm on that rapid conduction pathway, everything excites at the same time. So I get a rapid depolarization event of the ventricle, which gives me my QRS complex, right? Followed by ventricular repolarization, okay? Now look at what I'm seeing on a surface EKG. I see atrial myocytes and I see ventricular myocytes. I don't see nodal tissue. I don't see rapid conduction pathway, His bundle, bundle branches. I don't see any of that. It's too small. It doesn't make up enough of an electrical signal to be detected on a surface EKG. It is far too small. There's not enough mass for it to show up on a surface EKG. This is the 10,000 perspective. I only see big things. And the only big electrical signal is what comes from the meat of my ventricle and the meat of my atrium. Okay? So normal conduction has a very predictable sequence of events that occur. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
And it can happen very rapidly in the ventricles because that signal is distributed almost instantaneously to all those myocytes at the same time, as opposed to the atrium, which is a slower depolarization because there's no rapid conduction pathway in my atrium.
What's Bachmann bundle?
Bachmann's bundle is kind of, well, it's a little bit of an electrical pathway, but it's not nearly the efficiency of the ventricular system, okay? So kind of what I diagrammed here on the board, but really kind of detailing it out, let's look at all these different electrical properties and how they appear on a surface EKG. So here's my surface EKG, right? This is how I appear from the 10,000 foot perspective, okay? This is how I appear at each individual myocyte that's involved and the time that it's involved. Now remember, my ventricular muscle and my atrial muscle make up the bulk of my cardiac myocytes. So they will make up the bulk of the surface EKG, okay? So I have a sinus node that triggers an event. That event is triggered right here, the beginning of my P wave, right? So I have atrial depolarization and my classic myocyte pattern, right? And that correlates with P wave depolarization. Then I have this slow AV nodal delay, and I don't trigger or release that signal until I hit my mid PR interval, at which time I get rapid conduction, very rapid conduction through these bundle branches, Purkinje fibers, right? I'm not nodal tissue, so I don't have that rounded shape. That's characteristic of nodal tissue. This is very rapid, efficient conduction through these pathways and ultimately to my ventricle myocyte, which is going to cause ventricular depolarization in a big QRS complex. Okay, so I only see ventricular myocyte electricity, and I only see atrial muscle electricity on a surface EKG. Okay, that's all I can see. But if I have pathology in my conduction system, or I have disease processes of my nodal tissue, I will be able to identify that based on what these intervals look like. So a long PR interval suggests slow AV nodal delay, right? A wide QRS suggests slow conduction through my ventricle. Make sense? As opposed to rapid conduction. Yeah.
So I understand the QRS and the ventricles. Can you explain the T wave? Where is it sensing the... Is there an action potential with the T wave?
So T wave is just the repolarization event.
There's no action potential.
You don't see repolarization of the atrium because it's buried in the QRS complex. Mm-hmm. Otherwise, you would see it in here. Okay? What you're seeing is a repolarization event of your ventricle is what the T wave is. So right here's my ventricular muscle, and I'm repolarizing right here.
Okay.
That's what I'm seeing is the repolarization event. I can't see that for my atrium because it's buried here in my QRS.
Does the muscle mechanically stay squeezed until it repolarizes? So when that ventricle squeezes at the QRS, is it squeezed until the T wave?
Does that correlate?
Or is it just squeeze and let go, and then once it's relaxed, it starts to repolarize? Or is it squeeze, and now it's repolarizing, and that causes it to rise?
Not sure exactly the timing of the mechanical, but I would just remove the mechanical pairing to this. Because I can't tell you exactly how it is or where it falls in that process, and it probably depends a lot on the bulk of my myocyte, right? How long does it take to fill? But at the rate, sometimes it takes longer to refill, or I can fill more because I got a slower rate. So I would say probably the vast majority of your filling happens after all this takes place, okay? Because filling takes time, and this is looking the matter of like 0.2 to 0.4 to 0.6. I mean, we're talking about 0.4 milliseconds, and I don't fill that fast, right? So I would say that my filling probably takes place well after that.
Are your common bundle all the way down to your freaking deep fibers, are they sealed pathways? Or does it not release until the Purkinje fibers? Because you think you would start getting particular contraction down the septum.
You do get a little bit of initial contraction. You do get a little
so
bit of initial.
Off from the
right. No,
right.
They're not closed off. Okay. But what it does is it says, but that's happening at a rate of half a meter per second. So even if I start to depolarize some of the septum, my signal is going to be transmitted out far faster than I can depolarize that septum, because I'm 4 times and 8 times the speed of that in terms of meter. I'm going to get out there much faster. What it does is it gets that peripheral tissue, or that kind of all that muscle, to squeeze at the same time. That's what's important. So you'll see a little bit of things happening in a series there. But it's not sealed in. It's not like the signal is only released from the terminal ends of the Purkinje fibers. It just makes sure that that signal gets distributed rapidly everywhere, so I get a consensual response. Or concentric, not a consensual, concentric squeeze. So automaticity, we talked about that. Sinus node cells, their automaticity is between 60 to 100 beats a minute, and that can be influenced by parasympathetic, sympathetic system, drugs, all kinds of stuff. The AV node and His bundle, primarily the His bundle cells, are going to be 40 to 60 beats a minute. So they have an intrinsic rate of automaticity at 40 to 60. This is my junctional escape, usually comes from the His bundle, right? And then my ventricular escape usually comes from Purkinje fibers that go at a rate of 20 to 40 beats a minute. My primary pacers are going to suppress less efficient pacers. So whatever your fastest pacemaker is, it is going to set the rate for your heart. It will be the dominant pacemaker. And it cancels out every other pacemaker, because instead of them having an event that they auto-triggered, they were triggered by whatever the fastest pacemaker started. And once you go, you all reset back to zero. Right? Make sense? Yeah.
I know escape means it comes late. When you say escape, what do you mean?
When I say escape, I mean something that has not been triggered by the SA node, right? So I have a pause that was not triggered by the SA node. The subsequent beat is an escape beat.
Okay.
Now, that's different from an ectopic beat, right? Because I can have ectopic beats be pacemakers. Prime example of that is a VTAC. VTAC is a ventricular pacemaker. It's an irritable portion of the ventricle that goes at a rate faster than anybody else, and it becomes the dominant pacemaker. It's a dangerous rhythm. A dominant pacemaker from the ventricle, where it is now fastest, therefore the dominant pacemaker, and it is ectopic. Okay? It's not an escape, it's ectopic, meaning outside of the SA node. Okay? We'll take a break in just a second, okay? A narrow QRS indicates fast conduction through a very efficient pathway. My conduction system is very efficient, right? So a narrow QRS tells me that I have an efficient pathway where I have a signal that comes in at the AV node, travels through the His bundle, right, to the bundle branches, to the Purkinje fibers, and gets that signal out quickly all throughout the ventricle, right? It is intact and it is healthy. And the only way onto that pathway is at the top, okay? You can't sneak onto it from a little side route. You can only come in through the top. You can only come in through the AV node, okay? So I can't jump onto it. I can't start a signal in the ventricle and jump onto that rapid conduction pathway. You can only enter, it's like the expressway, right? There's a specific spot where you can get on the express lane. Once you hit that express lane, right? You can only get on in one spot, okay? A wide QRS indicates slow conduction, right? I have inefficient signaling. And we talked about this just a short while ago when I was here last time. There are several things that cause a wide QRS, right? So a wide QRS is going to be a ventricular origin rhythm, right? A ventricle origin rhythm, so an ectopic. An ectopic rhythm, right? Anything that originates in the ventricle. A PVC is wide, VTAC is wide, right? Those are all ventricular origin rhythms, okay? Or I have a problem, I have pathology of my conduction pathway. I have pathologic conduction. So a bundle branch block is a pathologic conduction, right? It's going to be slow conduction, so it'll be wide because I'm not getting that signal out quickly. Or I can have diseases of the channels. Diseases of the channels that populate my membrane. They're called channelopathies. Okay? Channelopathies. Sometimes, I don't even know if that's spelled right, right? Channelopathies. So that can be tricyclics. A tricyclic is a disease, TCAs, is a disease of my sodium channels. Okay? I can have inherited long QT syndrome. Right? I can have inherited all kinds of different stuff. But in general, channelopathies is going to be diseases of my channel, which impair how well and efficient I conduct, right? So wide QRS is either ventricular origin or pathologic conduction through my rapid system.
You say ectopic beats are only ventricular origin?
No, not all, just ectopic ventricular origin beats. I can have something like multifocal atrial tachycardia, right? Or wandering pacemaker. What's wandering pacemaker? Wandering pacemaker is ectopic pacemakers. I have a pacemaker, and I have three or more different pacemakers in the atrium, right? They all have distinct P wave morphology because when I look at that signal, I see it from a different perspective, right? So if you fire from this part of the atrium, it looks different to me than if you fire from this part of the atrium, which looks different to me if you fire from that part of the atrium. So if I'm looking at you from one perspective, I'm going to see three different shapes, right, on how those events take place. So I've got ectopic, but it's going to be followed by narrow QRS because I don't care where it came from. It still hits the AV node and gets conducted rapidly through the ventricles. Now if I have a ventricular ectopic rhythm, then it's going to be wide because I have no opportunity to ever utilize the expressway. Yeah. All escape beats are ectopic beats. They're outside of the SA node, right? Does that make sense? Okay. But an escape beat, we generally refer to as when I don't have another signal, right? Escape beats are like, hey, I need a safety net. Somebody do something, right? That represents only one. That represents usually my bradycardic rhythms, right? I can have ectopic pacemakers that are out of control and wild, right? That's my tachy dysrhythmias. So when we refer to escape beats, I'm generally referring to these safety net beats that kind of pop in when nobody else is doing anything, as opposed to this overly excited pacemaker who's running away haphazard, okay, and out of control. Does that make sense? So I can either use fasting conduction pathway, or I can be slow, ventricular myocytes, okay? French, it's gotta be French. Right? We talked about bundle branch blocks. So I have normal conduction all the way through here, converges, I get time to fill, I get rapid depolarization of this ventricle, but I get slow depolarization of this side because I'm blocked, okay? So now, this is where I start to see things where I've got an RSR prime because I've got asynchronous depolarization on my ventricle. This one fired, then this one fired. So I got two spikes now, as opposed to they all fired at the same time where I see one spike. So you'll see those RSR prime patterns frequently where it's depolarization of one followed by the next, as opposed to together, right?
So. Why doesn't it, or does it? It seems like as the signal crosses the septum through myocardial cells, that eventually that left bundle branch is going to pick it up again and then run
nope.
real fast.
I can't pick it up.
Well, but what I'm saying is past it.
Back here?
As it goes through the septum, through the regular
You mean
regular
like
cells.
Jump back onto this?
Yeah,
I can't jump back onto it. I can't
jump
back
on.
No, I can only get in through the top. I came in through the top. It's blocked here. There's no jumping back on a healthy pathway. I can only get in from the top.
Can't go.
I can't get back on that pathway. I can only get in from the top. And this road dead-ended. Now I hit a dirt road. As opposed to...
So excitability is kind of a one-way street.
That's what my wife says.
Just kidding.
Just kidding. That's just perfect. That's perfect. yeah.
What was your question?
Yeah, I can't jump back on there, right? So I have rapid ventricular depolarization, slow ventricular depolarization. And I know that depolarization event makes a big QRS complex, right? So now instead of them happening at the same time in one spike that's narrow, I get two spikes. One fast one, one slow one. Okay?
Like
RSR prime is characteristic of that pattern. Now, let me throw one thing in there quickly, okay? One of the ways you'll be able to distinguish a ventricular morphology ectopic beat versus a bundle branch block is remember, one half of my QRS complex happens fast with the bundle branch block. So I'm only half slow. And when we start to look at it in detail, we start to look closely, which we will today, you're going to see with bundle branch blocks, the first half of the QRS complex is fast. The second half is slow. So I'm really only half wide in a bundle branch block. Whereas if I'm a ventricular origin beat and I fire from over here, I'm slow depolarization of this ventricle, slow depolarization of that ventricle, and I'm slow on both sides of the QRS complex. Okay, we'll get into that. But it shows, you'll start to look at that QRS and say, that first half of that QRS complex is fast. It's not wide all the way through. It's not slow, slow. It's fast, slow depolarization. Okay? Make sense?
Does it have to be right at that spot, or can we still have the same...
You can disease anywhere. You can disease down here. You can disease up here. You can disease up here.
Will it have the same signal?
It'll be a little bit different probably, but generally, remember, I'm looking at the big depolarization event, not the minutia of where this blocked at. I'm looking at the big depolarization event from a surface EKG. Okay? Does that make sense? So, normal rapid conduction is indicated by a P wave, followed by a QR. Now we're putting the language together. Okay? Now you should understand what the language means. P wave followed by a narrow QRS complex. That is normal, rapid conduction that begins at the atrium, follows atrial depolarization, and utilizes a healthy conduction pathway system. A P wave followed by a narrow QRS. Okay? Absence of a P wave, no P wave, suggests I have an ectopic origin of a rhythm, right? I have a rhythm that started outside of the SA node. Actually, if it's no P wave, I have a rhythm that started outside of the atrium. I started either in a junctional site and I have a narrow complex beat because it originates in the AV node or the His bundle, so it still can come into that rapid conduction pathway. So that's a junctional escape versus it started in the ventricle, no P wave, it's wide, that's a ventricular escape. Okay? Intervals.
Can you go back for one second?
We'll take a break, I promise. Give me 6 minutes. We'll take a break at 12:30. You guys can have lunch. Okay? Is this making sense?
Mm-hmm.
Is it kind of clearing some of the stuff up? So we'll get into rhythm interpretation. We'll get into 12 leads. We'll get into the good stuff here, okay? But we got to lay out this foundation. Have to. Okay? So, intervals. Deviations of normal intervals represent pathology in a system. That pathology can be blocks, things like long QT syndrome, Wolff-Parkinson-White syndrome. You've all heard of that, right? It's going to manifest itself as a deviation from my normal intervals. And I know this looks busy, but you have to understand a few things. Okay, there's three intervals I care about, right? Three intervals, that's it. I care about my PR interval, right? My PR interval, which is the beginning of the P wave to the initiation of my QRS complex. I know it sounds bizarre. It's not P to R, it's P wave to the beginning of my QRS complex, okay? That's one that I care about. Two is the width of my QRS complex. Okay? And three is the QT interval, which is the beginning of my QRS complex to the end of my T wave. Those are the three intervals that matter. My PR interval, my QRS interval, and my QT interval. Okay? What do they need to be? How do I remember them? Well, remember, what's our boxes? Let's make it simple, right? I'll tell you right now what they have to be, but truthfully, it doesn't really matter, right? Because you're going to say, all right, here's my quick way of knowing, okay? So my QRS, I know that it should happen in 120 milliseconds, 0.120, okay? If I break down my boxes, that's three little boxes. So my QRS needs to take place within three little boxes. Okay? If it's beyond that, it's considered wide. Okay? My PR interval needs to be less than one big box. If it stretches beyond one big box, which is five baby boxes or little boxes, it's wide. It's a long or wide PR interval, okay? My QT interval should be less than two big boxes, okay? I think it's easiest to measure a QT interval like this, because a lot of the times you have to correct it for rate. So if I have two subsequent events like this, right? I got a P wave, QRS, T, P wave, QRS, T. I want my QT interval, QT needs to be less than my R to R interval. Less than half of an R to R interval. So I look at subsequent R peaks here. And I say, is this interval less than half of this interval? And if it is, I'm happy. Okay? If it's not, then I show a little bit of concern. Okay? Make sense?
Yeah, we haven't really gone over that.
Yep, you're going over today.
So,
we just did 2 seconds ago. What are you talking about? We're not going over it.
What
has happened? Just happened, man.
What is happening now?
I've got delayed repolarization, right? That's all it means, right? I'm not saying anything about how fast I depolarized my ventricle. All I'm saying is from the point that things started to the point that I'm ready to go again is now pushed out, is delayed, okay? I have a long QT. And when I delay that, I make myself prone to arrhythmias. And you'll see things like torsades in people with long QT, because they are more prone to having a second signal jump in at an abnormal time and initiate an R on T phenomenon. Okay? Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm. Why do you give us two large boxes as versus the R to R, half of the R to R?
I like half the R to R. That's what I use all the time.
Makes more sense.
Some people like to say, is it within two big boxes? It's just another way to say, to gauge it. If you got a really fast rhythm, sometimes it's hard, and you'll get a long QT because I got a fast rhythm. And so you look at it, you're like, oh, shit, that's long QT. But truthfully, it's just because I'm so fast, like 140 beats a minute, so everything looks like long QT. And then I'll say, all right, these really fast rhythms are at least happening in less than two big boxes. So I kind of use it as a backup measurement for fast rhythms, which can sometimes be difficult to apply this one.
So if it's long, if it's fast beat, it won't ever be over two large boxes, will it?
No, because it's not how long it's taking me to depolarize, repolarize. That doesn't change. Well, you can get a little bit of change in that, right? The event itself, the duration of that event doesn't change. It's how fast my next beat comes on top of it. So if I have a normal conduction followed by another fast conduction, right, a second beat, as long as this is happening in the same phase, I just trigger the next beat faster. Now think about things like epinephrine. I'm a chronotrope, inotrope, dronotrope, right? I'll increase your rate. I'll increase your rate of conduction, and I'll increase how fast and powerful you squeeze, right? So if I give you some epinephrine, everything kind of shrinks up a little bit, right? Because I'm going to conduct everything a little bit faster. I'm going to repolarize it a little faster. I'm going to be ready for my next beat a little bit faster, right? So generally, it'll correct itself. It's just a second way to make that calculation. Who's this guy?
Reinhardt.
You've seen this before. That's the first three lead, right? How sweet is that? Right? Those are the limb leads, right? That's why they're called limb leads, because you put your limbs in the bucket of water, which was a conductor.
Is that thing in a museum somewhere? It's got.
I would love, if I could ever find that, I would just sit and stare, man. It's just brilliant, right? It's hard enough for me to learn on modern technology, but to actually think this stuff up, hey, it's pure brilliance, you know? It's brilliant. He said, look, I know that everybody's a little bit different, but in general, there is a predictable pattern to electrical conduction of the heart. And we can see deviations in that. We can say that's a pathologic condition. This is a brilliant guy. Brilliant guy. Right? This tool is an incredible tool. It'll become one of your greatest allies in emergency care. Okay? Think about your H's and T's. Right? What are your H's and T's in resuscitation? Hypoxia, hypovolemia, hypothermia, you can throw that in there. Hyperkalemia, hydrogen ion acidosis, what are your T's? Tamponade, tension pneumo, toxins, thrombus, PE, thrombus MI, right? So 5 or 11, or 10 or 11, right? Believe me, it's come up before. How many of those can I use an EKG to help me make the diagnosis? Hypothermia, right? Hyperkalemia, thrombus MI, thrombus PE, toxins, cardiotoxicity, that 12 lead is an incredible tool. You pop that out on your arrest and you've already addressed 5 of your potential pathologic processes. Okay? An incredible, powerful tool. All right, we got to take a break because I can't delve into this until you guys are like, totally focused. And you can't do that with a
half hour?
Yeah.